Hello everybody and welcome to this beautiful, breezy, and still colder yet Tuesday afternoon. Today is the 14th of March. Just kind of been looking out today and just watching it. It doesn't seem like winter is wanting to let go, but I'm feel sure that here soon old winter will give it up and transfer into spring. For those of you that don't know me, my name is Rob Milbourne. I know you probably haven't seen me very often. Hopefully sometime soon that will change. I'm sitting in today for Pastor David, kind of giving him a little bit of a day off, a little break from the norm. Wanted to get with you about a few announcements, things that are coming up in the church. The first is our missions team, our inaugural missions team, is taking off tomorrow morning, very bright and early. Matter of fact, I don't even know that it'll be bright. It'll definitely be early to Nicaragua. So this week, throughout the week, you know, if you're just kind of thinking, man, what could I pray for right now? Pray for the missions team, you know, for their safety, for their impact, and also pray for the impact that will be had on them. You know, this is a great responsibility, but it's also a great gift. For people from Mount Pleasant, North Carolina, to get to go down to Nicaragua and show the love of Christ to you know, people that they might not otherwise have ever met, you know, kids, adults, the elderly. You know, they're going to be down there building a church, you know, a better facility for believers. And there's something to be said for believers who are going and you know, building facilities and making worshiping Christ a little bit more comfortable for people who are in other parts of the world. So be praying for them, and also be watching Facebook, because I know they're going to be posting updates and things that they encounter while they're there. So make sure you're looking out for that on the movement. The next thing that is coming up is March 18th. Actually, let me take a step back. This Sunday, our church will actually have an opportunity to take part in observance of a traditional, authentic Jewish Passover. Our church is actually going to be hosting a missionary to the Jews. And one of the things he'll be doing while with us is kind of going through the process and the tradition of the Passover. And, you know, for those of you who are kind of historically minded and have a desire to understand what some of those old traditions looked like and what they would look like today, this is definitely going to be a Sunday you don't want to miss. This is one of those things where there will be a lot of questions answered, I think, in the way that it's presented. So make sure that you're there this Sunday. You should be there every Sunday, but this one especially. Also on the 18th is the Dealing with Dementia seminar at the Mount Pleasant United Methodist Church. That's going to be from 8:30 to 1 p.m. You know, dementia has become such a prevalent thing anymore. I think mostly through, you know, the advancements in technology and people's understanding of you know, mental disability and ultimately deterioration with age. So at this point, it's almost impossible to find someone who hasn't been impacted or will be impacted by dementia. So this seminar is actually going to help people educate on how to deal with dementia, better understanding of it, and how to better care for those loved ones who are dealing with dementia. So again, that's the 18th at the United Methodist Church in Mount Pleasant, from 8:30 to 1 p.m. And then on the 19th is the special service. So that's the Passover service. Also, this is the official broadcast invite for all of the men of the church. I know back in February, a bunch of us went down to Woodstock, Georgia for a Johnny Hunt men's conference. It was absolutely amazing. And I also know that there were a lot of men who couldn't make it for one reason or another. But here's your second chance. At Prospect Baptist in Albemarle, on the 24th and 25th, they'll actually be doing the Take Aim Johnny Hunt's Men's Conference. He'll be here. He's going to be basically facilitating the entirety of the event. It'll start at 5:30 on the 24th. It'll end that evening at 10 p.m. They'll dismiss at 10. Then the next morning, it'll start at 7:30 and be done by 10:30 in the afternoon. This kind of overlaps on what we would normally have as our men's breakfast, but we wanted to make sure that there was the opportunity for all of the men in the church to actually go and experience this. A lot of our guys that went in February will be going again. Tickets are $50. You can actually go onto the Prospect Baptist Church website and register there. You'll just scroll down and it'll say register now. Click on that link and it will actually take you through the process where you can pay online, get your ticket. The $50 covers your admission. It also covers the meal at Friday night, and then course materials and things like that for the conference. If that's not enough of an enticement, I'll give you the menu for the evening. It's a half-grilled chicken, slaw, baked beans, roll, and a dessert. So if the prospect of being amongst other men of the church and other believers from other churches and getting to really sit down and hear a message preached by a guy who's a phenomenal communicator and really has a heart for discipling men is not enough, I think the food will roust up a few of you. So make sure that you go online there. Again, Prospect Baptist Church in Albemarle. Go to their website, scroll down to the Take Aim link, and then click on Register Now. That'll actually take you through the process. Again, it's $50. That's all I have right now for announcements. I wanted to kind of read a little thing to you, and it was something that as a Christian, when I first came to Christ and first started having an understanding of what it was going to take to be a Christian, the most common question I asked was, "What now?" I'd heard preachers, "Repent, repent, repent," and I'm like, "Okay, I did that. Now what?" I'm kind of a list maker when it comes to certain things, and being a Christian was one of those things that I wanted to make a list, kind of. What do I need to do? What are the steps? How does this play out, towards my salvation? How does this play out towards me being the Christian that God wants me to be? And it's actually laid out. It's pretty simple. And kind of in line with, Pastor David is always talking about, Paul's and Timothy's. Every Paul find a Timothy, and every Timothy find a Paul. Or even better, there should be three people, or two people in your life at all times. The one who's leading you, and the one that you're leading. So it's kind of this perpetuation of the faith. The older in faith, not necessarily in age, bring up the younger in faith. And as that progresses, and you age in the faith, you latch on to someone who's maybe younger than you in the faith while still maintaining that student relationship with the one who's ahead of you in the faith. But one of the really, I'm kind of a list guy, so this really made a lot of sense to me. And it's actually, I know a lot of times it's referred to as, the seven virtues of Christianity. At least I've read it that way a few times. But it's in 2 Peter, and I'll read from verse 2, and we'll go to 8, and then we'll kind of go back and recover everything. Grace and peace be multiplied to you in the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord, as His divine power has given to us all things that pertain to life and godliness through the knowledge of Him who called us by glory and virtue, by which having been given to us exceedingly great and precious promises, that through these you may be partakers of the divine nature, having escaped the corruption that is in the world through lust. And this is kind of where it starts picking up on those virtues. But also, for this very reason, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge self-control, to self-control perseverance, to perseverance godliness, to godliness brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness love. For if these things are yours and abound, you will neither be barren nor unfruitful in the knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. So we'll go back to 5 and kind of pick at it a little bit. I know I said 7, and a lot of times it's referred to as the 7 virtues, but also the first one that's kind of spoken about here is giving all diligence. Now for me, that's a virtue. So I would, personally, I would add that because I think it's indicative of being a Christian is that diligence. And basically what diligence is an intentional effort. It's hard work. So what Peter's talking about here, and remember this is Simon Peter, the rough and tumble fisherman. He drew a sword on a Roman soldier and cut his ear off. Carried a knife, cussed a lot, and liked to fight. So a lot of us can identify with this guy. Giving all diligence. So giving all intentional effort. Kind of put it in a perspective, going the extra mile to grow as a Christian, making an effort. Now, I'll also point out to you that going the extra mile is actually a biblical reference, and you can find it in Matthew 5, verse 41, where Jesus is preaching the Sermon on the Mount, and he says, "He who compels you to go 1 mile, go with him too." That's where we get going the extra mile. It's actually a biblical reference that a lot of people who aren't Christians use all the time. So that's kind of, next time you hear that coming from the mouth of someone who's not a Christian, maybe you can kind of throw that out there to them. But it's this idea of going the extra mile to grow as a Christian, making an effort. You've come to faith, and that's what he's talking about. Adding to your faith that belief and understanding and knowledge of God, and you can't see God in his true form, but you know and you understand that he is there, and you know that he loves you, and you understand this to the point of salvation. So the first one I would say is diligence, but then he says add to faith virtue, and virtue, or to virtue knowledge. Virtue is a high standard, it's a quality of standards. And basically in kind of the Christian walk, these are almost the steps of progression as a Christian. The first being virtue. Now mind you, these don't necessarily come in any particular order. These are just kind of a broad spectrum of how we're to grow as Christians. So the first is, a high moral standard. And this is almost like an alignment. You're taking your life and your thoughts and the things that you do, and you're going to align those with the purposes and the will of God. So virtue is having that high standard. You could almost say a high standard of living, because it is a Christian life that you live, and aligning that with God's agenda and his will. And then to virtue, add knowledge. The knowledge in this part of the text is actually an experiential knowledge. It's not necessarily book knowledge, although that is absolutely paramount to growth as a Christian. This is more of the experiential knowledge. You know because you've experienced it. And I think a lot of times we place a lot of value on what we would call book knowledge, but in our culture, we don't place a lot of value on that experience experiencing God, experiencing what it is to have a life that's aligned with the desires of God, what it is to have a life aligned with the characteristics of Christ, of being a Christian. Then you would add self-control to knowledge. Now, if you notice as we go through these, each one is kind of is built on the foundation of the previous one. So, virtue, having a high moral standard, would come from having diligence, being diligent about seeking God and seeking Him in your life, and then knowledge would be kind of built up by that virtue. You know, in order to experience God and His hand in your life, you have to have yourself aligned with the things that He has for you. The self-control. Self-control is the command, the personal command over your desires and emotions and the way that you express those in what I would kind of call tough situations. Having that command over your emotions and your own personal desires in a tough situation or, say, in a high-stress situation, what that's going to do is allow for God to talk to you in that situation. If we blow up or we get super emotional in a tough time, there's that propensity to kind of focus inward on ourselves. What am I going to do? What have I done? Where am I going to end up? But when we have control over that, when we learn to have self-control over our own personal desires, over our emotional reactions to situations that we're in, there's the ability to kind of calm down for a minute and listen, and get quiet and listen for God to speak to us and tell us where to go, how to react, what about our personal desire is in or out of line with His desire for us. The next is perseverance. So add to self-control, perseverance. So we've got this higher standard of living because we've aligned ourselves with God and His desire for our life. We've had this experiential knowledge gained through that alignment with God. We've been able to experience Him. Through experiencing Him, we've learned to slow down and listen to Him. And now we grow into perseverance. This is kind of like long-term self-control. This is the steadfastness, despite difficulty in life situations. So we've had self-control, which is, controlling that desire, the emotion, or the way that we express those in tough times. But perseverance is doing that kind of continually over a more extended period of time. And then godliness. Godliness would be kind of a characteristic devotion to God. Having a desire to be completely devoted and sold out to God and His will and His desire for our lives, which is when you go through perseverance and you've aligned with Him and you've gained self-control and now you're doing it on a regular basis, that becomes part of a lifestyle to persevere through the tough times, but not just on your own grit and determination, but in that comfort and in that relationship with God, you start to realize that God brings you through these things, and there's a growth that happens, and then you start to progress in this idea of godliness, this devotion to God. Regardless of what's going on, I'm going to be on God's side. I'm going to be with Him in His will, not my own. And then you add to godliness brotherly love. Brotherly love is just exactly what it is. It's that cherishing of other believers. You love other Christians. You love others who are in the faith. You cherish them. You grow in relationship with them. You grow as a family together as you grow as a Christian. And incidentally, it's not a coincidence that brotherly kindness is part of this growth package. It's difficult to be kind of a one-man show or a one-woman show as a Christian. It's very tough. So in building those relationships and fostering that brotherly love with other Christians, that's kind of where you get to, we use it all the time, iron sharpens iron. So there's a growth that takes place when you're around other Christians. It's also indicative of the whole concept of Paul's and Timothy's. So there has to be that relationship with other believers, it's inevitable that you're going to fall in love with your brothers and sisters in Christ. It's going to happen. When you serve each other and when you serve together, it's almost impossible for that family relationship, that bond, to grow. And then to brotherly kindness, you would add love. Love or charity. Love for humanity. It's... Again, these all kind of build on each other. So, love other Christians first. Because when you love other Christians, you're loving people outside of what would be your normal sphere, maybe. So you learn to love people who have differences with you. Maybe it's a work difference. Maybe you do something that, that type of job always has a, kind of a head button relationship with someone who does this job. But because you and this person are Christians who fill that same those two jobs, you have that commonality that you can come together on, despite the fact that maybe, during your normal work week, you might be conflicted with the things that, each of you do. But when you have that kind of familial love with other people from other backgrounds, other jobs, other financial statuses, things like that, in a loving environment like the church, you grow to have a better understanding of how to love people outside of the church. It's almost kind of like an incubator in the church to grow and foster that heart for other people. And then you've also got a team of people that you're working with. So as you grow in that brotherly love, you can then take that out to the rest of the world. So diligence, which is, an intentional hard work and effort to grow as a Christian. Virtue, a high moral standard, kind of that alignment with the things of God. Knowledge, which is the experiential knowledge, not necessarily book knowledge, although it does come through, time in the Bible and studying and in learning about everything that you can get a hold of on God and His desire for your life and what His intention is with all of creation. Self-control, being able to maintain kind of a calmness in difficulties of life. Perseverance, that long-term, steadfastness and being able to kind of control yourself. Godliness, which is your quality of devotion to God, which kind of grows out of that perseverance and continually leaning on God, through tough times, and that's where your godliness will come from, is leaning on God in those tough times. Brotherly love, cherishing your brothers and sisters in Christ, and then as that grows, loving other people outside of the church. Because ultimately, You know, we talk about, you know, Paul's and Timothy's. These are Christians. But at the same time, there are people outside of the church who God has called to become Christians. So it's up to us to grow in love for each other, to build each other up so that we can go out and love the world around us. And, you know, those people who are still in the world, who God has called to become part of the family. So that was, again, you know, it was a question that I asked a lot of times, like, what's next? You know, and I kind of ran across this. And again, it's not necessarily something that, you know, you've got to check it off in that order. You know, God has his ways of dealing with all of us, and he adds to all of us in different ways. You know, I know sometimes my self-control is not necessarily, you know, my greatest quality. So keep that in mind as you're kind of growing, as you're walking the walk. You know, and it's 2 Peter 2-8. That's kind of the progression of you know, coming to faith, and as you grow, you know, to be more effective as a Christian. Hope everybody has a good week this week. Again, stay in constant prayer for the missions team as they go to Nicaragua. I think it's going to be a huge impact on the people in Nicaragua, but I also think that there's going to be a gigantic impact on our missions team. And, you know, when they get back, just be ready to receive that impact, because I think they're going to bring a lot of it back. So have a good week, and we will see you again on Sunday.